Thank you. Please sit down. Ms. Valentine, Ms. Sharma, ladies and gentlemen, on behalf of the staff and students of Bolton School Girls Division, it's my great privilege to welcome you to our presentation evening. And it's a pleasure to start tonight's proceedings by inviting Amanda Valentine, the Vice Chairman of Governors for the Girls Division, to give her address.
Thank you. Well, good evening, everyone. On behalf of the governing body, may I extend my own welcome to you all for the annual Girls Division presentation evening. It's always a pleasure to be able to celebrate the achievements of the A-level and GCSE cohorts, as well as individual prize winners. I've been a member of governing body for some years now, and I still remain impressed by the commitment shown by governors and the time they give to further the success of the foundation. The governors set the strategic direction of the foundation and ensure that we remain true to our ethos and that we have a robust financial base from which to operate. The vast majority of governors have strong connections to the school, and I would hope that there are some future governors sitting within the audience here this evening. I've been particularly proud to be the Girls Division Vice Chair of Governors this year. The ISI inspection, which took place at the start of the summer term, was due recognition of Mrs. Carl's leadership of the division and a credit to the hard work of all the staff and pupils. As an old girl from the era when speech day was a fairly dull and lengthy affair, and when the whole school would try to refrain from making a noise on a squeaky chair, I'm sure that this evening will be a much more pleasant event when we can celebrate both academic and extracurricular success in music, sport, and service to others. For many of the Year 13 families, this evening will mark the end of having a child, or perhaps more fittingly, a young adult at Bolton School. I was in your position last year. James had completed his final year at school. In many ways, it can be quite an emotional time. Life will feel very different without the constancy of the school routine and an involvement in the many activities that are on offer here. So, to the newest alumni, thank you for returning to school to mark the end of your time here. For some, that may have been a relatively short period in the sixth form, or at the other extreme, you may have been a part of Bolton School since Beech House. I hope that you've been happy here and that you have achieved your goals. Remember to embrace everything that is on offer to you as you embark on the next stage of your career. Be bold and make a difference in your world. It's a credit to you with your hard work and the support of your families, friends, and your inspirational teachers that you have achieved some excellent results. Well done. So now to the newest members of the sixth form, congratulations on your GCSE results. I imagine you are really enjoying the freedom of being out of a school uniform. I hope that you will relish your sixth form years, that you will thrive on the activities on offer, take pride in your surroundings, especially the newly painted B corridor, that's amazing, and that you will enjoy being role models for the younger years. Evenings such as this are not just about academic life. The sense of community at Bolton School should be recognised and celebrated. The Girls Division has a reputation for its commitment to volunteering, and the sheer number of pupils successfully completing the Duke of Edinburgh Award schemes is incredible. The role we play in our local community is an important part of the all-round education on offer here, and has a big impact on our own development as well-grounded individuals. I was so impressed to see that this year the Girls Division has raised a record sum for charity, raising over £22,000. Well done, and thank you everybody who's taken part. We are each lucky to have a team behind us to provide inspiration and support individual success. And on behalf of the governors, I would like to thank all the staff in the Girls Division and across the foundation for all their sheer hard work tremendous effort and dedication throughout the years. Finally, please enjoy the evening and thank you for attending.
Thank you, Amanda. It really is a joy to stand before you tonight in this magnificent hall, a place that has witnessed countless ceremonies, celebrations, and successes over the years. The Great Hall stands as a testament to the storied legacy of the Girls Division, a legacy that each one of you continues to shape and uphold. Today we gather not just to celebrate individual achievements, but also to recognise the collective spirit, dedication and excellence that is the hallmark of Bolton School, and to enjoy the pride we feel when we reflect upon the journey of growth that our students have embarked upon. 2022-23 was a busy year and was particularly notable for the fact that it was the first normal school year for some time. It's worth remembering then, when we're celebrating the pupils' successes this evening, that they have had to overcome the various difficulties presented by the pandemic, not least of which were lockdowns and online learning. And for those, a good deal of resilience has been needed at a very formative time in their lives. Noteworthy is the fact that our Year 13 leavers here were only the second cohort ever to have sat their A-level exams without having previously sat their GCSEs in the normal way, and they coped admirably with this summer, despite this being their first experience of formal external exams. Well done to you. It was also the year, as Amanda has just said, when the long-awaited and overdue ISI inspection of the Girls Division and Hesketh House took place. And you will know that in the two categories for which a grading is given for this particular inspection, namely quality of pupils' academic and other achievements and quality of personal development, we were judged to be excellent. The report could hardly have been a more positive report and is testament to the hard work of a superb body of teaching and support staff from within the Girls Division and across Foundation Services. I have no doubt that you will already have read the report from cover to cover, but I couldn't possibly pass up the opportunity of a captive audience to expound on just how terrific it was. The quality of our pastoral provision is of fundamental importance to me, and so I was especially pleased to see that this aspect of school life was rated so highly, and was delighted to read comments such as, "Pupils in all year groups commented positively about the many opportunities provided by the school and the outstanding support they receive." I'm very proud of the work that we do in this area, as I'm sure you already know. Our new pastoral area, the Hive, has been a notable success and was one of the many areas of the school that impressed the inspectors. More generally, on the pastoral side of school life, the inspectors noted that pupils demonstrate notably high levels of self-confidence, self-awareness, and self-discipline. That pupils are empathetic, respectful, and tolerant. They value and celebrate the school's rich diversity. The inspectors commented that pupils' social development is excellent too, that they collaborate extremely well to achieve common goals. And they said that pupils show an exceedingly strong sense of community, showing a deep commitment to service and contributing positively to the lives of others within school and beyond. In the category of pupils' academic and other achievements, highlights from the report included the comments that pupils are highly motivated and have outstanding attitudes to learning, that they achieve exceptionally high levels of success in diverse extracurricular activities, that they are highly articulate and demonstrate excellent communication skills, and that pupils attain at exceptionally high levels in public examinations and achieve consistently high knowledge of skills and understanding at all ages. Awaiting GCSE and A-level results days this year was a particularly anxious time, given the heightening press over the summer about the dips in grades that students were warned to prepare themselves for. And it's certainly true that that nationally grade distributions are closer to pre-pandemic levels than any of the sets of results since. But we were delighted that at GCSE, around 60% of the grades were 7 to 9, and around 40% of those grades were 8 to 9. At A level, 42% of the grades awarded were either A or A star. And these are superb results, I'm sure you'll agree. Needless to say, the vast majority of our Year 13 leavers are moving on to their first choice of pathway, whether it be to study their chosen subject at university, to study for a degree apprenticeship, to take a gap year, or to move straight into employment. The Girls Division continues to thrive, and we remain proud of our ability to recruit so many bright and capable pupils, with 865 pupils currently on roll, compared with 774 immediately before the pandemic, resulting in an expansion to sixth form entry in Year 7 last year and also this year. Academic success and pastoral support are just parts of what we do here, of course. Students at Bolton School have an outstanding array of options open to them in terms of extracurricular activities, from sport to drama, from music to debate, from trips to educational lectures. It's very clear to us how important these activities are in a pupil's development and in preparing them for a wider world. On a night such as this, I can't list every success and achievement. As anyone who's attended our weekly whole school achievements assemblies would attest, those accolades are many and varied. I hope also, though, that through the weekly email to parents and through our use of social media, you've been able to see some of the great things that your daughters have been doing on a daily basis. It has been great to see how well our sports teams have performed over the last 12 months. For example, our under-18s lacrosse team won the Northern Schools tournament and then went on to come ninth in the national tournament. Our under-12s, under-13s, under-14s, under-15s and under-16 teams all managed to become Bolton Town Netball Champions last year, with the under-14s also becoming the National GSA Independent Schools Champions. And the senior netball squad were runners-up at the under-18 Greater Manchester County Tournament. The Girls Division water polo teams also had an extraordinary year, with both the under-15s and under-18s becoming the national champions last year, whilst our under-13s were silver medalists, losing their final by a single goal. Our under-13s became the Greater Manchester badminton champions too. There's been considerable individual success in sport too, and our relatively new Elite Athletes programme has been designed to give extra support, both academically and pastorally, to individuals who participate in sport outside school at a very high level. Music and drama continues to play a fundamental part in school's ethos too. You'll see a list of individual successes in Associated Board and Trinity College examinations in music in your programme, including that of Emily Bowden, who achieved a diploma with distinction clarinet. As well as the many and varied concerts and recital evenings, in June, the lower school production of Beauty and the Beast in the Girls Division Theatre was superb, as was the joint upper school production of Great Gatsby in the Boys Division Hall. In March, we returned to the Bridgewater Hall in Manchester for an exceptional joint music concert. And I'm grateful to all of those staff who contributed to all of those events. Elsewhere in your programme, you'll see the names of those pupils who achieved silver or gold D of E awards this year. This is quite a feat, with the awards covering assessments in volunteering, physical and skills sections, as well as undertaking an expedition. Not all achievements are measured by exams or competitions, of course, and each one of you has grown and learned and contributed in a variety of different ways. As Amanda said, our standing in the community is important to us, and it has been a particularly successful year for our Community Action Programme. Between September and May, Girls Division Year 12 students volunteered for over 7,000 hours of their time. and the achievements of those peoples were celebrated at our annual Community Action Evening in June. We were invited to the Commonwealth Observation Service at Westminster Abbey for the first time this year, and the 8 pupils selected to represent school were chosen for their significant contribution to the wider community. Primary outreach work took off last year, involving over 100 local schools, with thousands of pupils taking part in the various activities that we provided. Indeed, I can't wait to see what this hall will look like in a few weeks' time when we have over 50 schools coming in for our STEM Day. I'm both excited and daunted by the prospect. As the profile of our partnerships and outreach activity continues to build, we will continue to explore ways in which we can form partnerships in the area which will allow both pupils in the school, together with others in the community, to benefit for the incredible assets and talents that we are lucky to have here in school. For all that we're celebrating tonight, let's remember that success is seldom a journey taken alone. Behind each pupil stands a formidable support system. Parents, teachers, and friends who have believed in you, often more than you have believed in yourself. And so, as we commend individual achievement today, we should also celebrate the strength of our school community. I have no doubt that our Year 13 leavers will want to thank individual teachers later this evening for the amount of support that they have given them throughout their time at Bolton School. I too would like to take this opportunity now to pay tribute to our talented, dedicated staff and to the hours they dedicate to going that extra mile for you. You are fortunate to have benefited from such expertise. I'm really pleased too to be joined by colleagues who've come up from Hesketh House tonight to see their former pupils here and to share this celebration with you. This summer, 4 of our longer standing members of teaching staff left the girls' division. Mr. Ball in physics, Mrs. Crowther in art, and Mrs. Hone in classics retired from teaching at the end of last term. And Miss Caulfield, my PA, also left for Pastures New, and we wish them well in their new ventures. We also recognise the service to the school of 3 former members of the Girls' Division staff who sadly passed away this year. Barbara Morley, who was a former head of Modern Foreign Languages, and upon her retirement, an active member of the All Girls Association. She would have been 100 in May, an occasion that the All Girls Association was looking forward to celebrating with her, but I'm sure they will have raised a glass to her nonetheless. Pat Bellis, a former member of staff and former parent, and who also served as chairman of the All Girls Association from 1985 to 2002. Pat was a stalwart of the All Girls Lunches and the committee for decades, and she also will be much missed. And Marion Corkhill, former head of biology, who taught in the Girls Division from 1970 to 2003, and who is also remembered by many, including some of our current colleagues. As well as recognising all that the staff do to make Bolton School what it is, may I also express our thanks to our governing body for the many hundreds of hours they give in support of school, its development, and its continuing success. I'm also grateful to all Friends of Bolton School, including the Parents Association volunteers, for all that they do. There wouldn't be a fireworks night without them, for example. And then there's the All Girls Association itself, which later this academic year will be celebrating its 135th anniversary. The origins of the association began with the Past and Present Club, which was formed in March 1889 at the instigation of the headmistress at the time, Miss Johnson. A celebration event will be held in school to mark this auspicious anniversary. Our Year 13 leavers are now old girls themselves, and as such, join a body which continues to provide support to current pupils through a number of different ventures, such as International Women's Day activities, Perspectives career lectures, and this year we've launched the All Girls Mentoring Scheme, Steps to Success. This year we also saw the inaugural Alumni of the Year Awards. Dr. Sheila Fisher and Rebecca Turner were particularly worthy Girls Division winners, and it was inspiring for current pupils to hear about all that they have achieved since leaving school. I was pleased too that after hearing Rebecca talk, our school council was motivated to raise funds for the Blue Skies Hospital Fund, which she founded. So I'm terrifically grateful to all of those who give up their free time to support all of school's various endeavours. To the parents and grandparents in the room, especially those of our leaving Year 13s, I first want to extend my heartfelt gratitude to you in entrusting your child to us. Your unwavering support and encouragement form the backbone of your child's success. And I know that behind every student celebrating tonight, there are family members and friends who sat through endless revision sessions, provided countless cups of tea, and perhaps sometimes bitten their tongue when the going got tough. I hope you will feel that your sacrifices, both big and small, have paid off. Tonight is, as Amanda said, a bittersweet occasion for those parents who are about to see their child flee the nest, but it's also one of excitement, watching them take their next steps and revelling in the pride for all that they have achieved. And please don't despair. Take it from one who knows. It really isn't long before they come back home again. To our leavers, it really is lovely to know that many of you have very fond memories of school. Yes, it's always a delight to have a good read through your yearbook and to see the affection that you have for each other. I was particularly struck by comments such as these. Camilla is the funniest and most beautiful person I've ever met, but we're only friends with her because of her brothers. Amelie takes pride in being a compulsive, pathological liar, and a good one at that. You cannot believe a word that comes out of her mouth. Next year, she'll either be an engineer, or in the RAF, or a dentist, or whatever, if she hasn't already ended up in jail yet. If you feel as though you're being judged by Khadija, you probably are. Her RBF is unrelenting. Jess will forever be known as the girl who fainted in front of the whole school on picture day. Well, she will now. Molly will definitely leave a mark on our hearts and on the keys of the school grand piano. I've known Aisha since she was little, so forever. Don't be deceived by Emily's beauty. She is the weirdest person you will ever meet. But we wish her all the best in university. And most importantly, we wish her flatmates good luck in dealing with her. Her face might say otherwise, but Izzy is a lovely girl. And also your exploits. When Emily is not making pasta, she's travelling to London to see Harry Styles on a school night and coming in the next day straight off the coach from the station. It doesn't make clear, but I presume that Emily is meeting Harry Styles in concert. But I'm not 100% sure. I'll always remember, it says, the time when Emily and I stayed up late writing that disgraceful story and published it the next day. I haven't found it yet, but I'm looking. When most people think of Safa, they think of the girl who fell out of a limousine at prom. But there's so much more to her than that. Lexi loves to do the worm down the middle of the Great Hall. Will we see that tonight, I wonder? Reading further, though, I discover that she's somewhat less adept at the magic mic dance. Tanya makes her subject, I shan't share which, sound a lot more interesting than any teacher ever could. And finally, we're so grateful to Ruby for allowing us to live vicariously through her interesting love life. Well, well, what an eventful year you've had. And year 12s, pay heed, because I'm watching. I'm making notes, and yes, I will do this to you too in a couple of years' time. Teasing aside, though, it is genuinely heartwarming to see the great affection that you have for one another. And this is the note on which I'll end my speech. As I said at the start, tonight isn't just about individual triumphs. It's about reflecting on our sense of community, collaboration, and camaraderie. There will be times when you've struggled, times when success seemed elusive. Some of you have had to fail real adversity, and I greatly admire you for handling this. Your stories shape who you are. In the coming days and years, our students will scatter across various universities and other career paths. But no matter where you go, you will always carry a piece of Bolton School with you. The lifelong friendships, the unforgettable memories, and the invaluable lessons that have been learned both inside and outside the classroom. Ralph Waldo Emerson, a popular American philosopher, once said, "What lies behind us and what lies before us are tiny matters compared to what lies within us." In your time here, you have begun to discover what lies within you, and we look forward to seeing where that takes you. Stay true to yourselves, value your heritage, and strive forwards with determination, compassion, and integrity. Congratulations to you all on your achievements, and here's to every future success that awaits you. Thank you. Please would you now stand so that we can sing together our first hymn, "I Vow to Thee, My Country." Please sit down. I'll invite our students in a moment to leave the hall to assemble on the corridor, leaving by the doors at the front of the hall. Whilst they're assembling, the audience will have a chance to listen to Cynthia Chung, who will perform Chopin's Nocturne in E, Opus 62, number 2. So would year 12, our leavers and our mystery prize winners please lead out.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Cynthia. That was much appreciated. We'll begin our presentations now with the Midstream Prize winners, whose names will be announced by Mrs. Green, Deputy Head Pastoral. Next will be GCSE presentations announced by Assistant Head Ms. Teichman, who is our Head of Upper School. And finally, Mrs. Winder, Deputy Head Academic, will announce the A-level prizes. Some students are unable to be here tonight, but we shall read their names regardless so that they're properly recognised. In the case of GCSE and A-level presentations, names will be read in groups of five with time for applause between each group.
Good evening. Throughout this section of the evening, we will read the names in groups of five. Please do save your applause for that pause between the groups. Amelia Carla, Steel Prize for Progress in Year 7. Scarlett Carter, the Claire Keat Trophy for Progress in Mathematics. Phoebe Chook, Catherine Critchley Prize for Service to Hesketh House. Madeline Eccleshare Hornby, the Year 10 Dual Linguist Award. Amelia Gaffney, the Steel Prize for Progress in Year 7. Annika Harish-Kuma, the Collins Junior Poetry Prize. Helen Wang, Wainwright Prize for Contribution to School Life for Upper School. Sophia Macari, the Wainwright Prize for Contribution to School Life for Lower School. Alice Nielsen, the Year 10 Dual Linguist Award. And Evie Percy, the Steel Prize for Progress in Year 7. Chloe Ramirez Nieves is awarded the Dorothy Farwell Prize for Service to Beach House. Stella Bocek is awarded the Williams Senior Poetry Prize. Mira Salvi, the Lower School Writing Prize. Grace Sully, the Lower School Prize for Drama. And Amy Weldon Foster, the Steel Prize for Progress in Year 7. Natasha Williams is awarded the Catherine Critchley Prize for Service to Hesketh House. Kate Wilson is awarded the Steel Prize for Progress in Year 7. And Carla Zimbia is awarded the Steel Prize for Progress in Year 7.
Good evening, everyone. Very warm welcome. I'm delighted to read out the names of Year 11 2023 and also delighted to see everybody back. We have Amina Ahmed, Alicia Ahmed, Alina Ahmed, Rabia Ahmed, and Fatima Ali. Zainab Ali, Ruby Anderson, Emma Arneson, Zaina Atcher, and Harriet Atherton. Abigail Babishi, Eleanor Bartolotta, Beatrice Baxter, Clarity Brabin, and Anna Brennan. Anya Brohi, Annika Bullen, Sophie Chan, Ella Chandra, who is also awarded the prize for food preparation and nutrition, and Maisha Chowdhury. and Amelia Cowan. Sophie Cutler, Olivia Dance, Frankie Dewhurst, Flora Day, and Imogen Ferrier. Jessica Frayne, Megan Fong, Amira Gettins, Gabriella Gambattista Hunt, and Amia Goel. Emily Graham, Bethany Green, Molly Grimshaw, who also is awarded the Veronica Carr Cup for History, Ava Grundy, and Maya Gahapa Carter. Maliha Hafeji, Adifa Hafeji, Evie Hall, Vivian Hall, and Charlotte Harris. Ella Hilton, Naomi Hitchin, Alexia Howarth, Lottie Howard-Sinney, and Caitlin Hurt. And Zara Cadva. Tavleen Kaur, Sally Kendall, Isa Khan, Fatima Khan, and Safia Khan. Gabriella Kusa, Karishma Lada, Aisha Lackey, Ashlyn Lau, and Sophie Lynn. Eva Liu, Sandy Liu, Victoria Longthorne, Ritty Ma, who also receives the Melody Prize for Design, and Tegan Mayer. Liba Mahmood, Uzaina Malik, Mia Marin, Isabel Martin, and Ashley McCabe, who is awarded the Clark Prize for Religious Studies. Zara McCann, Olivia Melling, Fatima Mohammed, Zahara Mohammed, and Charlotte Ong. Nuttall, Mia Owen, and Davina Parbat. Nadia Parker, Amara Patel, Farah Patel, Zainab Patel, and Naya Pomian, who is also awarded the Michael Dillon Prize for Chemistry. Sanya Rahman, Marianne Rahumathula, and Gabby Reed. Charlotte Riggs, Aisha Saeed, Anushka Sharma, Ishani Singh, and Jasleen Singh. Caitlin Smith, Lana Spurdal, Natalie Stahl, Poppy Grace Stebbins, and Ethan Steer. Ria Sudhakar, Sophie Swift, who is also awarded the prize for textiles, Alicia Taylor, Emma Taylor Beardsworth, and Shreya Toll. Erin Turner, Aisha Ugradar, Getchi Amedi, Olivia Walker, and Mia Waters. Bingyu Wang, Tilly Watkinson, Emily Worley, Ruby Whittle, and Freya Wood. Isabel Worth, Catherine G, and Tareem Zafar.
To make sure that our prefect team are ready for A-levels. They're doing a marvellous job there, handling all these envelopes we've got. So, Imani Adam, who's awarded the Bennett Prize for Biology, Safia Adia, awarded the Horn Prize for Classics, Khadija Ahmed, awarded the Diamond Prize for English, the Nan Shepherd Award for a new entrant to the medical profession, Rameza Ahmed, and Yakin Al-Kabi, who's awarded the Susan Mary Simpson Art Prize. Who's also awarded the Ken Henderson Prize for Business Studies, Polly Asquith, Alicia Backhouse, Maria Baps, who's awarded the Anne Tankard Award for Textiles, and Molly Bell, who's awarded the Booth Prize for Historical Research and the Dorothy Barley Prize for Religious Studies. Billsborough, who's awarded the Parks Prize for Classical Studies, Ruby Broughton, Lauren Bunting, Summer Burke, and Kelly Chain. Next is Grace Chan, Amelia Sharova, Cynthia Chung, who's awarded the Francis M. Ricketts Prize for Music, Faye Clarkson, who's also awarded the Helen Lee Bramwell Prize for Geography and the Porter Prize for Progress in the Sixth Form, and Amelia Cole. Jessica Crompton, Rose Crowther, Jasmine Curtis Walker, who's awarded the Isla Bishop Award for Physical Education and the Mabel Fielding Award for Geography, Aisha Darsot and Ella Davey. Charlotte Davies, who's awarded the prize
Prize for Economics, Katsia Diakobana, Jessica Dixon, who's awarded the Prize for Product Design, Lucy Dixon, and Sasha Doyle. Emily Duncalf, Helena Flanagan, Bella Granger, who's also awarded the Pam Johnson Memorial Shield and the Nan Shepherd Award for a new entrant to the medical profession, Sarah Habab, Carol Habib, who's awarded the Nan Shepherd Award for a new entrant to the medical profession, and the Seddon Prize for Mathematics. Sophie Hackwell, who's awarded the Leslie Prize for Geography and the Marilou Scott Prize for Progress in Biology, Martha Halford, Safa Hassan, Isabel Heaton, and Beatrice Hughes. Umama Ifkar, Fiza Imran, Akifa Ishmael, Kashena Jedwer, and Emily Jefferson. Next, Alicia Jeever, Aisha Jeever, Georgia Johnston, Megan Jones, and Divya Kallat. Eraj Kayani, who's awarded the Todd and Livingston Prize for History, Charlotte Kennedy, Safa Khan, Saima Khan, and Khadija Katak. Mia Kitching, Alice Leary, Isabella Lee, Grace Lyon, and Olivia Maguire. Mariam Macker, Ramin Malik, who's awarded the Nan Shepherd Award for a new entrant to the medical profession, Katie Malley, Jessica Martin, and Georgia McGinty, who's awarded the Dorothy Lees Blakey Prize for Drama. Zina Miller, Bipisha Mistry, who's awarded the Dorothy Varley Prize for Religious Studies, Khadija McGuardia, Isabella Morgan, and Martha Morrow, who's awarded the Graphic Communication Prize. Kiana Murray, Halima Nathar, Mia Neal, Blake Owens, who's awarded the Mary Moon Prize for Media and Journalism, and Safa Patel. Shreya Pindoria, Millie Price, Alicia Quinton Taylor, Camilla Rafai, and Tasia Rees, who's awarded the Prize for Politics. Ruby Rimmer, Elizabeth Rogers, who's awarded the ABC Oldroyd Prize for French, Lucy Sackfield, who's awarded the Rob Dobson Prize for Engineering, Sabah Saleem, and Hannah Sarwar. Mariam Seedat, Evie Sells, who's awarded the Hearst Award for Services to the Community, Hamna Shafiq, Zara Shahzad, and Emily Sham. Kate Shanley, Tanya Shembaga Kumar, Avneet Singh, Karina Singh, and Violet Somerville, who's awarded the prize for psychology. Indira Taylor, Hamira Thagia, who's awarded the Riley Prize for Service to the Community, Alara Unsel, who's awarded the Prize for Spanish, Lexi Vincent, and Francesca Williams-Denton, who's awarded the Isla Bishop Award for Physical Education. Shepherd Award for a new entrant to the medical profession, and Zara Youssef, who's also awarded the Nan Shepherd Award for a new entrant to the medical profession. And finally, on to the Head Girl and Deputies Team of the year 22-23. Our Head Girl, Annika Maney, is awarded the Vera Garn Prize for Leadership, and the Deputies, Anania Adjit, is awarded the Phyllis Noella Hamilton Prize for English, the Prize for Latin, the Eleanor Domain Prize for Outstanding Contribution to School Music, Martha Brennan, Hannah McKee, who's awarded the Parents Association Prize for Chemistry, the Parents Association Prize for Physics, and the Wainwright Music Prize, Sophie Patel, who's awarded the Rachel Tazica Computer Prize, and Ella Worsley, who's awarded the Old Girls Association Award.
To sing our second hymn, Jerusalem. Please sit down. That was the best and most rounding version of Jerusalem I've heard sung in the hall for some time. So thank you very much. I'm pleased now to be able to welcome our speaker, Shweta Sharma. Shweta was a sixth form student here and sat her A-levels in 2001, whereupon she took a place at the University of Manchester to study for a BSc in management. Since then, she's driven growth and transformation in technology, entertainment and media. A seasoned commercial strategist and digital innovator, she crafts and grows consumer-centric products and services. Shweta's leadership includes pioneering Microsoft's Xbox entertainment business across Europe, the Middle East, and Africa, and leading the digital games distribution business for Disney, Europe, the Middle East and Africa. Shweta holds diverse roles such as non-exec, trustee and advisor now, and is a board trustee for the Youth Sports Trust, a leading UK children's charity, about which she will say more later. Since 2022, Shweta has volunteered as an alumni mentor in the Sixth Form Entrepreneurship Scheme here at Bolton School, a role we appreciate greatly, and I look forward to hearing from her today. Shweta.
Thank you for such a warm and thorough introduction. I feel like you've stolen half of my speech. So that's good news for you. It means I'll be done quicker. Ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests, and the incredible students who we are here to celebrate today, thank you. It really is an honour to stand here before you, commemorating the achievements of the year, and also to celebrate the success of the students who've worked tirelessly towards their goals. This journey, your journey, is testament to the power of grit, determination, and I've no doubt some late nights stressing and studying. As I stand here reminiscing about my time at Bolton School, which was when I joined in the sixth form in 1999, I'm overwhelmed with nostalgia, the memory of the laughter, the nights out, and the questionable fashion choices come flooding back. I may not remember the historical events of those years, but I remember the outfits, and I'm absolutely astounded that they're making a comeback now. It was a time when the world seemed conquerable, and the realm of possibilities stretched infinitely before us. My yearbook predicted I'd be the next Richard Branson. And whilst I'm not launching spaceships, or nor do I own my own island, I do know a thing or two about navigating corporate galaxies, and I'd like to share a little bit of my story with you today and some of the lessons that I've learned along the way. My academic journey at Bolton School saw me study business studies, chemistry, and biology. Business studies resonated with me. It just clicked. I dabbled in the Young Enterprise Scheme, and I even produced a play. However, when it came to chart my course beyond school, I was at a crossroads. Do I follow a structured career, such as law, which I'd done some work experience, or do I go into the unpredictable world of business studies? For me, it felt like choosing between a finely tailored suit and a brightly coloured dress. Both have their merits, but it was the bright colours of business studies that I decided to choose. As mentioned, I studied management science at university, which for those who don't know, is a combination of business and management topics. Wait for it now. During those years, I wore many hats. I served as the president for the largest society in Manchester. I flew planes with the Royal Air Force. I interned at KPMG. I spent a summer in America teaching horse riding. I worked on a trading desk in London, and I indulged in travel, revelry, and perhaps a few too many hangovers. None of that was easy, and all of it pushed me out of my comfort zone. But I was driven by the notion that I had very little to lose and potentially a lot to gain. It was through the myriad of experiences that I found that I enjoyed the strategic work that I'd done at KPMG. So lesson number one. I hope you can see I didn't have a plan that was meticulously laid out. I was, in essence, rudderless, but I was saying yes to exciting opportunities that I believed would form building blocks in my story. One of the pivotal early moments in my career was when I was due to take a year out travelling after university, and those plans were scuppered. So I found myself looking for jobs in the July before knowing that the September was the graduate entry scheme, and most of the jobs would be likely to be filled. I couldn't apply for Deloitte's strategy programme because all the places were filled, but they still had some places available in operations, so I thought, why not, I'll apply. During my first interview, the interviewer asked me, why didn't you apply for strategy? It seems like such an obvious fit for you. Lesson two, setbacks and barriers are a part of life, but they're not insurmountable. Your unique voice and experiences matter. In my second interview, I was unofficially told that I not only had a job, but they'd opened up a spot in strategy for me. My 5 years consulting at Deloitte exposed me to the foundational skills and the ways of thinking that I still use today. I traveled the world, getting to work in places like the Caribbean and in building theme parks in Dubai. Deloitte remains still remains one of my most memorable experiences. It was competitive and full of smart people, but it was a place where you're encouraged to think big and challenge. Yet, after 5 years, I had the itch to get my hands dirty and move from advisory into a hands-on job. This led me to a strategy role at Disney, working across Europe, the Middle East, and Africa, where I delved into new technologies and digital Disney products. It was at Disney I stumbled into the world of gaming, when I was tasked with running the digital games distribution business for the region, a daunting challenge. And I asked myself, could I really do the job? Lesson 3, when overwhelmed, remember there's always room to learn. Seek mentors and learn from people who know the ropes. Stay in the room. A director role at Microsoft Xbox came knocking, a significant step up that triggered the same nervousness. But one of my proudest moments was building the Xbox Entertainment Division for Europe, Middle East, and Africa, revolutionising how we use TV and entertainment at the time. So lesson 4, seize opportunities. Don't wait until you're fully prepared. It's rare for you to tick all the boxes in advance, so leave room for growth. During my working time, I've been given many a funny look when suggesting a new idea. It's like a rite of passage. So lesson 5, challenge the status quo. Just because it's always been done one way doesn't mean it's the only way or the right way. Continually reassess. And as Ross repeatedly said in Friends, pivot. And yes, I pivoted more than Ross has been married. My time at Xbox crystallised my passion for thinking outside of the box and seeing opportunities to create and build products that make life better or simply more fun. This has become my guiding compass, my superpower, as I like to call it. So lesson 6 comes from Bill Gates. Dive deep into what you're passionate about and are good at. Contribute to that space, and the path to impact will become clear. I ventured into working with startups, and I relished the contrast against the corporate world. After several other corporate roles, including leading the online business for luxury retailer Harvey Nichols, and as the vice president of digital at a boating company, quite a career tapestry, I know, I now work in what is known as a portfolio career, where I take on a variety of advisory roles. It offers the freedom of choosing how and when I work, but it comes without the safety net of a full-time job. In recent years, in addition to my advisory work, I served as a board member on BT's Technology Advisory Board, working alongside the Chief Executive and the Chief Technology Officer. I'm a trustee for the Youth Sports Trust, which is a brilliant children's charity, and a mentor to women in leadership and tech. And this year, I have the privilege of working on the Entrepreneur Scheme with Maya. Given my experience with startups, I created my own travel tech startup, but I had no idea that COVID was around the corner. So, you've guessed it, I had to pivot. Life wouldn't be life if it wasn't full of surprises. This is a snippet of my story, and yours might look very different. You might already have a master plan, but remember, life is messy. And these diverse experiences, though challenging at the time, build resilience and confidence. Your journey will not be anything like you think it's going to be, but surprises are good for you. Don't fear change. You can always change your mind. Make choices that work for you and be comfortable, but never small. This is your journey. So I've shared 6 lessons with you today and I'd like to recap them. Number 1, it's okay to not have a defined plan. Seek experiences that keep moving you forward. 2, setbacks and barriers are inevitable, but temporary. Use your unique voice and experiences to your advantage. Number 3, when you're overwhelmed, make room for learning and seek mentors. 4, never wait until you're fully ready. Seize opportunities. 5, challenge the status quo and pivot when necessary. 6, dive deep into your passion, contribute, and the path to impact will become clear. As everyone's journey is so different, I asked some former Bolton School students what their advice to you would be. Here's what they had to say. Always take pride in your Lancashire roots. The northern connections will extend far in both business and social circles. Don't lose your accent. Follow your passions and interests instead of pursuing a course or a path that you think is right. Degrees only demonstrate your ability to apply yourself. 3. Don't be dead set on a particular career path. Things change. Get lots of work experience in whilst you can, and then make a decision. University is sometimes viewed as a prerequisite for success. Consider alternatives to university. Apprenticeships and on-the-job training can offer valuable experiences. Prioritise earning money whilst gaining experiences. Academic ability will carry you so far, but life experience and the ability to create rapport with others will carry you further. One said, "At 18, I was worried about growing apart from my friends, but distance doesn't break bonds. And don't forget, new bonds form too." Another said, "Currently, you might be all about achieving, but remember, your health, your mental well-being, and your relationships matter too. Invest in those areas." People think less about you than you think. Stop being so self-conscious. To conclude, this is your journey, your chance to make an impact in the world. So do it your way. And if you ever think you're too small to be effective, then you've never been in a tent with a mosquito. Thank you.
Staff here at Bolton School and all those in attendance this evening, I would like to begin by extending a huge thank you to Shweta for taking the time out of what sounds like a jam-packed schedule to deliver such an inspiring speech. Please can you all join me and put your hands together again for our speaker this evening. Year 13s, I am sure, will remember your speech when they're struggling to get out of bed for a 10 a.m. lecture, and now I'm even more excited to start university, having heard of all the incredible activities and groups you participated in while studying at the University of Manchester. From flying as a pilot in the RAF for 2 years, to working abroad for one of the big four firms, then putting on some Mickey Mouse ears, and running the show as the manager of Disney's digital games distribution across Europe, the Middle East, and Africa, to then switching the game board and directing the strategy and business development sector at Xbox for 3 years. These are only a few highlights of your incredible career so far, and to say that you have been very modest in your speech today would be an understatement. Since leaving school, you have helped to transform the technology and entertainment sectors, whilst taking the time to mentor women in tech and empower many more to follow in your footsteps and embark on careers in a sector typically dominated by men. I'm sure everyone here will take away something from your insightful lessons you have shared today. In particular, her lesson 5 resonated with me personally. With no certain career plan in sight just yet, your advice about accepting exciting opportunities and taking advantage of your special experiences in order to move forward is something I'm sure we can all agree is the perfect guidance for many of us here, unsure what next steps may be following A-levels. Furthermore, your fourth lesson applies to all of us here, whether that's moving on to sixth form or leaving Bolton School and entering adult life. Your mantra of seizing every opportunity and your path becoming much clearer is the exact inspiration we need, and it's been very reassuring to hear this from a fellow Bolton School girl. For our new old girls and year 12s here this evening celebrating their fantastic results, maybe like me, you wonder where exam grades will lead. Shweta's diverse and extraordinary career is the exact inspiration we all need. With countless opportunities now being open to you, take inspiration from Shweta by seizing every one of these opportunities and enjoying every minute of it. The great success Shweta has achieved is sure to act as a great motivation for the students this evening. We're only a week into the new academic year, and I have to admit, Riley Centre already feels very strange not seeing the faces of last year's 13s. Despite the fact the new year 12s make the comfy area, as we call it, feel busier than ever, your absence has felt and we're all missing you. You have set a truly brilliant example, and I would love to congratulate you all on your amazing results. If the next step for you is university, taking a gap year, or joining an apprenticeship, I am sure you will all succeed and somehow break the already great expectations you have set. Let's just say these high standards are now nearly impossible for us to meet. I also must mention the incoming Year 12s. Congratulations to all of you for your impressive GCSE results, and we welcome you with open arms into the Riley Centre. I look forward to getting to know you all, and as long as you don't take the last Diet Coke from the vending machine, I'm sure we'll all get along amazingly. All that remains to be said is that we wish you the very best of luck in your future endeavours, and to quote Schwater, always remember to pivot!
Thank you very much, Schwater, and also to Phoebe, our head girl, for her vote of thanks. I'm pleased now to be able to welcome our head of foundation, Mr. Philip Britton, for his address.
Thank you very much. What a conundrum the speaker presented to those parents in the audience. Do you laugh at the Friends joke or not? If you do, you have clearly watched this American sitcom. And if you don't, are you a little more highbrow? Anyway, I noticed that some of you chose to deny knowing what she was talking about. And lying isn't good. Today, I learned a great number of things. Every day is a learning day at Bolton School. I learned what an Xbox was. I've written that down for future reference. It's my job, first of all, to present three of our most prestigious prizes and then to add my own thanks to finish the evening. The Girls Division are indebted to Ross Warburton, an old boy of the school, for his proactivity a number of years ago in recognising that the Boys Division had had a Popplewell Award for many, many years, which provided a scholarship for university study. He was rightly furious that there was no such equivalent for the girls' division, and both through his actions and his generosity, he established the Warburton Scholarship. And it's a great pleasure to award the Warburton Scholarships this evening to Safia Aria and Emily Jefferson. Since the 500th and 100th anniversary in 2015, the school has administered, on behalf of the Leverhulme Trust, the Leverhulme Scholarships. These are also awarded to support university study for some of our foremost scholars. And it's a great pleasure to award the Leverhulme Scholarships to Khadija Ahmed, Molly Bell, and Ramin Malik. The Riley Prize is awarded by the Head of Foundation for the best all-rounder in Year 13, taking equal concern for academic progress and interest, for being part of the pastoral life of the school, a good friend, part of our community, for engagement in the many and varied activities at school, and for looking outwards beyond the school and its engagement and partnership with the community in which we live. And it's a great pleasure this evening to award the Riley Prize to Sophie Patel. I was saying, it is a great pleasure to join the Girls Division for this evening of celebration, of achievement, and for a great sense of pride in what the girls have achieved for those parents and family members in the audience and for their teachers. It is wonderful that we can gather to acknowledge all that has been and to look back on all of those achievements. And it's also good, through the remarks of our speaker and through the intent of some of those prizes, to look forward to what will be when you leave the school and go out to make your way in the world. It's a real pleasure to thank first Mrs. Entwistle and also our archivist Mr. Fairweather, who have provided the explanations of what the prizes are awarded are for, and who chose to decide to acknowledge that part of school life. It is the first year that has appeared in our programme, and I think it adds greatly to the sense of what you have achieved. Not just a prize awarded this evening, but a prize that has meant something to some people for a whole number of years, and therefore you stand in a long tradition of those who have excelled in that particular area of school life. We celebrate this evening and we celebrate particular people, but we know the attitudes and attributes that we are celebrating occur every day for everyone in our school lives, because that is what matters. And I would like just to finish by adding my thanks to some key groups in our school life, all of whom have been mentioned before but bear further recognition. Let me begin with the governing body. We heard of 7,000 volunteering hours earlier on from the sixth form. I would contend the governors, who are all volunteers, must come close to that contribution to school life in so many ways. You may well see them at events such as this, admiring the state occasions of school life, but that is not the engine room of governance. The engine room of governance is day by day supporting those of us who lead the school. So I'd like first to thank Amanda as Vice Chair of Girls Division and all of the governing body for their work for your school. May we give them a round of applause. And it has been alluded to earlier, but must be noted on an evening such as this. The success of individuals and of young people is driven by the passion of teaching colleagues, those who have chosen as the vocation for their life to work in a school and to dedicate themselves to improving and seeking the aspirations of the young. And in doing so, of course, set the bedrock for the next stages of our society. Those long-serving staff we heard mentioned and those who sadly have left us this year all shared two attributes that I think are central to the success of the school. One is that sheer passion for what they enjoy and their ability to inflict or instill that passion upon you. Their infectious enthusiasm for their own subject does make a difference to you day in and day out. And I'm sure those heading off from the school with their own subject interests will know to whom they owe a debt for that, their own passion. And the second characteristic that all of my colleagues share is their concern and interest in young people. It is a simple truth of society that not everyone cares about the young. They are sometimes considered to be an unnecessary inconvenience. But in many very, very obvious ways, they are the future, and that my colleagues have chosen to develop their talents and to give their career to developing our future in looking after you as young people is terrific. Let us give all of the colleagues a round of applause. Those colleagues in the girls' division are ably led by Mrs. Kyle, who has given her own colour to this evening, both in the formal presentation of the school and indeed in the obviously close relationships that must exist for her to tell those stories from the yearbook and to be met with laughter rather than tuts. That is the mark of someone who is leading a school and knowing that the relationships and how you interact with people are the important part of leading by example and making happen what must happen, most tangibly recognised with the inspection report. And that is wonderful, but far more recognised in how you have all turned out in her school that she leads. Let us give her a round of applause. And my thanks to those parents in the audience. You have been mentioned before. Your part in instilling in your young people the importance of education, your choices in putting education high on your list as you developed your own lives, of course, have been pivotal to the success. You have been there for all of the girls in the audience when they needed support. You have been there when what that involved was telling them exactly what to do, and at an age when they would then do that. And things moved on during the years to the time when you told them exactly what to do and they did exactly the opposite. And you still stood by them. And over time you worked out how to support these young ladies that we see before us as young adults, ready to go into the world, and you are with them and around them, and it will be a real pleasure when they return to your households for Christmas. Let us give the parents a round of applause, girls. And finally, to mention undoubtedly the most important people in the room, the young people who have been receiving prizes and certificates this evening. Whilst all of the parts of a school that I've mentioned so far are crucial, actually, the success of our school, all of those achievements that have been mentioned, are the sum total of all of your individual efforts, your own passions, your own commitment to what you care about, the causes that you have supported in our charitable endeavours, the commitment you give to the sport and the music, the interest and intelligence you have brought to the classroom and your studies that in turn has inspired my colleagues to enjoy teaching you. The success of the school is your success. I wish those of you leaving to embark on the next phases of your life all the best. And remember that our mission is simply this. You take your own self, the attitudes, attributes, skills and talents that you have out into the world and make a difference for good. Good luck.
Well, thank you, Mr. Britton, for your address and for your very kind words. And I'd like to ask the choir if they would come to the front to take their places for the school song. Once the music starts, please would the rest of the audience stand to join the singing of verses 1 and 3. you very much. Thank you to our choir and to Mrs. Wadey there. The relief on her face when that went well was there for all of us to see. Thank you. Please sit down. And the singing of the school song brings tonight's proceedings to a close. In a moment, I shall ask our departing Year 13s to lead out of the hall first and into the Riley Centre. And as has become traditional, I hope you will join me in applauding them as we send them on their way. After this, our current head girl will lead out this year's prefects along with our special guests. Following that, our Year 13 leavers and their guests are invited to join the staff and me in the Riley Centre. And if you were awarded a trophy earlier, please come forward at that point to have your photo taken with your award. For Year 12s, it will be time to go home, I'm afraid. It's a school night, no late night for you, but you'll get your turn in a couple more years. Before we go, may I just remind our leavers of a particular line from our school prayer. Much is required of those to whom much is given. I hope you will feel that you have benefited from the opportunities that you have enjoyed here. And I trust as you move forward to the next stage of your lives that you will seek to make a difference to the lives of others. And so I ask our leavers for one last time, please lead out.